Zelda Informer Podcast. Bum, 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 bum.
Hey, everybody, welcome to the Zelda Informer Podcast. My name is Adam. Thank you so much for joining us. If you have any of your own topics, theme song submissions, or anything like that, feel free to send those to us at ZeldaInformerPodcast@gmail.com. Once again, that's ZeldaInformerPodcast@gmail.com. Here is the news from this past week. This week, Pokemon Butts became their own product line, Triforce Heroes saw its first UK commercial, Two Men infuriated gamers online worldwide, and Sony gave up completely. Once again, my name is Adam. That opening theme song was brought to you by Brandon and Company, who has provided our theme song for all of time and till the end of time. The closing theme for this week is probably going to be Hero of Time Remix by Cheesh. You can find him and any other of the links that we, or articles that we may have mentioned, or will mention in the podcast, in the link down below on ZeldaInformer.com. Thank you so much for joining us, and this week I'm joined by...
Hey, what's up, guys? It's me, Chris. I'm actually the least important member of the podcast this week, because we have some pretty other great people with us. Yeah.
Good morning. This is the Nintendo kid coming at you.
Oh my god, I forgot about that. Oh my god.
This is Colin, and earlier this week, Adam and I found a channel on YouTube of some kid. He's just like a Let's Play channel.
Good
and it's amazing
morning.
Because he has, what, the average of maybe 4 or 5 views on every single one of his videos?
He is majestic. And
but he has like 300 videos on his channel, including like behind-the-scenes specials and the history behind the Nintendo Kid.
And
he
special episodes dedicated. Featuring the Nintendo Dad.
Oh yeah, like he has special guests. This kid is more dedicated than I think anyone will ever be in their life. And yeah. I aspire to
be the Nintendo Kid.
And he only has 27 subscribers.
Yeah, he's been doing it for years.
Are you saying he's underrated?
Yes, I actually subscribed just to show support, and Adam will probably put a link to his channel in the description. He hasn't posted a video in 2 years, but I want to change that.
One day he'll come back and he'll realize that the Nintendo Kid was what the internet needed.
We'll make him come back. We'll do it together.
Yeah.
It's a group
effort. We'll do a comeback. He'll be a special guest at ZeldaCon, our yearly convention.
Let's have him on the show. Let's have him on the show. Let's ask him
if he's listening. He's officially invited.
Let's ask if the Nintendo Dad ever came back from going out to buy cigarettes.
Oh my god. But last but not least, our wonderful guest for this week is...
Hi, I'm Matt Dannevik, and I really wish I was the Nintendo Kid. It sounds like he's got his together.
Oh, he really
does. Way more dedicated than I am.
I understand how you feel.
Go look up his masterful playthrough of The Rescue of Pops Ghostly.
Oh, yeah, man. So good. So good. But yeah, I dig around, make videos at Machinima for Inside Gaming. Before that, I was at Polaris for a little while. And before that, I was also at Inside Gaming. And then before that, I was at Game Trailers, but you never saw me because I was just editing and doing other stuff.
The mysterious background man, Dan.
Yeah. When I was at Game Trailers, we weren't even actually shooting anything. Like the most we'd do is like voiceover for review type stuff.
It features like a high-pitched young Matt Dannevik.
I only edited stuff and did a little bit of writing. I actually didn't do reviews at that
you did
point.
Important
still,
stuff
like,
behind the scenes. You made the magic come together.
I also got in trouble for picking like the worst freeze frames of the reporters and whatnot for thumbnails there, like I'd always do, like the most uncomfortable, and they'd be like, Matt, we probably don't want you to do one where she looks like she's say like, you know, just going like
mid sneeze.
Like that.
But that skill became very useful when you transitioned to Inside Gaming.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it's great. I think it's
tuning into embarrassment's important.
Exactly.
Welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you. Glad to be here.
Yeah. So, what have you been playing this past week, Matt?
Oh, geez. Well, actually, today I took a crack at Tony Hawk Pro Skater 5, which I was expecting to be completely unplayable and broken.
I'm still waiting on my Gamefly for that.
It's probably a
Wait, Pro Skater 1 or 2 or 3?
5.
Oh, 5. Five. Oh, wow. Sorry.
The recent one. Yeah. No.
The Revenge of Khan.
Yeah, the flop. Well, it's good because Lil Wayne comes with it, so if you have any pent-up aggression to Lil Wayne. If you have Lil Wayne is a skater in it.
That's weird.
And if you have
You can play as King Graham from King's Quest in the new Tony. Yeah,
really?
Which I think is pretty great. Yeah,
that's awesome. Wait, old King Graham or like young King Graham?
The new one from.
I don't like the new one. I don't like new King Graham.
Yeah,
I like the classic King Graham.
When is Activision going to bring back Doom Guy and Shrek and Spider-Man?
Yeah,
and
Spider-Man is great.
Darth Maul and
I remember playing as Iron Man. That was cool.
Yeah.
I have Pro Skater 2 and 3 in a game case like right next to me. And the Dreamcast. I have the Dreamcast version of both games.
You should tape them all together and make Pro Skater like 9.
Yeah.
That works like
Speaking of the Dreamcast, it got a new release recently.
Oh yeah, Volgar the Viking, which is a pretty great side scroller on Steam and Xbox One. Recently the devs actually developed a Dreamcast port that you can go and download and burn for free and play
it's
it on
amazing.
Your Dreamcast with no extra
work.
I remember
I had a month of like Xbox games with gold, and I was really pissed off because Volgar was only an Xbox One exclusive, like I had the 360. So it's like, oh, you can only put an Xbox One. I'm like, this game should be able to run on the 360. Why is that, Xbox? You've disappointed me. I'm mad at you. Microsoft should burn to the ground because I get way too passionate about video games. But now I can get it for free because the devs are awesome people. So thank you to them.
I'm looking forward to it. It's pretty great. Mm-hmm. The homebrew community for the Dreamcast is fantastic.
I've never gotten into the homebrew community.
They make
Dreamcast.
A lot of really good stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
One of the selling points and downfalls of the Dreamcast was it was so susceptible to piracy. So what was for a business is great for homebrew and actually, you know, making stuff.
And it doesn't help the thing runs on Windows. Yeah. So
yeah. I mean, I love the Dreamcast to death. I personally recommend it as one of the retro systems that you need to have as a gamer. It will change your life in the best ways.
It's kind of
do you need it?
Yes. Yes, you do.
It's kind of the... I usually see it as being the last retro console. Because it's kind of the last of that whole...
It's the last of an era. Yeah. We've talked about this before. You and I, at least, I know.
Yeah.
I don't know if we talked about it on the podcast. But there's something so magical. It is a perfect swan song for Sega. Like, if you're going to end on a note, end on something beautiful like the Dreamcast. Because it was such a failure... But it's something that I just hold so dear, and I just appreciate a lot of design elements about the Dreamcast. I feel like influenced games, in, like later on.
They sometimes sell like refurbished ones on Sega's website. It's
really,
really? Weird. Just
That's
occasionally,
good.
Time to time, they'll just pop up.
It's like, hey, we have like 30 in stock. You want one?
Too bad the disk drives are absolute garbage.
Yeah, yeah. But you get little VMUs. That's cool.
That's
cool.
Yeah.
I want to say the only thing that Sega really did right with the Dreamcast was releasing Jet Set Radio.
They released a lot of good games on the Dreamcast first. The Dreamcast...
Virtua Tennis 2 is one of the best four-player games you'll ever experience.
Are you being serious about that, or are you...
Dead serious.
Okay,
Flintstones Viva Rock Vegas is one of the best games ever made.
Sonic Adventure and Sonic Adventure 2 are both on the Dreamcast, and they're way better than...
I thought Sonic Adventure 1 was like one of the worst ones.
On the Dreamcast, it was great. On the GameCube, it's horrendous. It's a buggy mess. It's really, really bad.
Dreamcast is Typing of the Dead. Enough said.
Oh yeah, that's fantastic. Yeah, the keyboard for the Dreamcast is amazing. I love that thing.
Do your Phantasy Star online.
Yeah, Quake 3.
Games that matter.
Can this just be like Sega Informer podcast, and we just talk about
Let's
the Dreamcast all episode?
Oh, yeah.
The
whole time. Get Seaman. I want to get a Seaman unit for the office and just watch them grow, come hang out.
Wonderful. But Chris, what have you been playing recently?
I went back to Metal Gear, so I'm back on that.
Oh, which one?
What do you mean, which one? Metal Gear Solid 5. The Phantom Pain, my brother.
There's so many Metal Gears, it's right for me to ask which one. You said I went back to Metal Gear, and I'm like, the original Metal Gear?
No, I mean...
Or the MSX version?
I went and I took like a week off because I've been working a lot, I got back to it. I'm still at like, God knows, like maybe 5, 8% and stuff like that, because that game is just very long.
Dense. Very dense.
So I'm going to be powering through that, hopefully, through this next 2 weeks. And then maybe I can move on to something else. Just maybe, but I doubt it.
As for me, I've been playing a couple of things. System Shock 1 was recently re-released on goodoldgames.com. with a new control scheme and all
that. I didn't
mention
this last week. I just want to throw this out there. I think Link to the Past was also released on Green Man Gaming. So you could buy it digitally. It's really weird to see that on that store. But anyway,
it's
back
not
to
just Link to the Past. It's a bunch of virtual console games.
Yeah, yeah. I just mentioned that because it pertains to something that I was really interested in.
Yeah, because it's just a code.
Yeah.
They're just selling you a code. Otherwise, I've actually been playing, this can pertain to one of our topics, but I've been playing a few games on my PlayStation TV, because recently there's been a exploit that has been released, and it still works on the new system update that was released earlier this morning.
Oh, okay.
Of allowing you to play any PlayStation Vita, PSP, and PS1 game on the PlayStation TV set-top box.
And all you need is like an email, right?
Yeah, you just need to email yourself a couple files, and that's it.
Wow. It's kind of funny. It's weird. Sony has been making some headlines of its own this week.
Pertaining to the Vita as well.
It's the end of an era.
It's
the beginning of a new age of Nintendo dominance again. Like,
Is Nintendo dominating, though?
Sony announced that they're not going to be making a sequel to the Vita in any capacity. No, there's not going to be a successor to it, meaning that as it stands right now, the only company set to actually have a dedicated handheld platform is Nintendo.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
I think that's like being the only company that's has dedicated fax machines, if I'm going to be real for a second. Or like, just because there's a reason that other electronics, like, you know, companies aren't getting into it is because the 3DS is done real well and is still doing real well, but I think it's a dying segment of the marketplace. Really.
Maybe.
To have a huge, its own, like, having it being dedicated to gaming is, for an expanded audience, is a detractor, not an attracting.
Yeah. Well, that's why things like the YouTube app and other features like that, you want to push that on your mobile platform.
Yeah.
People say, like, you know, a lot of other companies are focusing more on mobile markets, like, you know, a lot of phone-based stuff. And I still say, like, there's still a reason for the 3DS and mobile, like, platforms like that, because the processing power is dedicated to games. It's dedicated to being able to run good, like, solid games, and it has, like, a dedicated control system for that, for interacting with those games.
Not to say that the PS Vita didn't do that. The PS Vita, like, technically, like, is the better system. You know, you can do so much more on the Vita, it's just no one wants to develop for it.
I've spent the last few episodes just, like, poking fun at Sony and all that, but, like, the
it's
truth is...
It's hard not to.
Yeah, I know, it's hard not to, but the truth is, I was actually excited for the Vita, I think maybe more than the 3DS was, when Sony announced.
No,
the
same.
Vita.
I was super excited for the Vita. The Vita sounded amazing.
The PSP, the PSP is one of those systems that wasn't really great, like, in practice, but kind of got a whole second life once you learned about all its, like,
the
really cool features.
The PSP, for me, was a very important handheld console. I played a lot of games on it. I remember having a lot of significant gaming memories from the PSP.
All that Sony had to do was learn from the PSP's mistakes and learn from a few other things they had been working on, like the Xperia Play. And the Vita would have been really great, but instead
when they announced the Vita, it seemed like that was the case. You know,
everyone thought it was going to be a Android-based handheld.
Yeah, and they added we added a bunch of new ways for the user to interact with the handheld device. You know, gives developers all this freedom. You know, built in like other touchscreens. I'm like, oh, that's cool. You know, it really just expands the horizon. It's not going to be used by every game, but it expands the possibilities of what a developer can add to their game to, like, give you more of a control.
And it ended up just repeating all of the same problems the PSP had.
And then added its own.
Yeah, exactly, with its overpriced memory cards, proprietary cables, the system itself being too much.
I mean, Nintendo kind of learned from, like, that mistake a while, way before the Vita was even announced. I'm surprised that they still kept going with that, even after seeing their own system not doing well with that concept, and other companies having a hard time with that same concept, because it wasn't really worth it.
Well, the difference being that when the 3DS was not doing well in its first year, Nintendo decided to like, buckle down and make sure there was games being released for it.
Not only that, they made incentive for people to have initially signed up for the 3DS. They showed, like, look, we care if you invest in our products.
Oh, like the ambassador program.
The ambassador program is amazing.
Yeah. R.I.P.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, there was the weird new ambassador program for the new 3DS.
I'm not sure.
It's like sign up to be able to buy the 3DS early. It's odd.
I mean, yeah, I don't see how that's going to work. I honestly, like, I still don't like how the 3DS or the Nintendo does their handheld thing where they, you know, we have the 3DS, the new 3DS, 3DS XL, all this BS. You know, they just can't go with, like, one console all around.
I mean, I think the difference, though, is that there's no real discernible difference except, like, size when it comes to the 3DS, the 3DS XL, and the
2DS. But then you have, like, the 2DS and things like that. Like, I understand
the only real jump has been the 2DS.
The near field?
To the new 3DS. And it's just a 3DS with a circle pad.
Yeah, yeah, punch. Yeah.
So, Matt, I remember you had your own little... You had some disdain for when we were saying that we were excited for the Vita. What were your thoughts on the Vita when you first saw it? You know,
well,
playing it, maybe.
To me, I had visions of, you know, when they did the Vita, they were like, oh, there's the second, you know, analog stick on it. And I was like, well, if this means you can play a one-to-one version of Call of Duty anywhere, because this was before Call of Duty fatigue was, you know, at its peak or whatever. I'm like, if you can play Call of Duty anywhere in the exact same experience you'd get on, you know, at home, I'm like, this is a system seller. This is
it's phenomenal.
And crazy. But instead what you got was a very watered down version of it, and data plans were expensive and weren't really meant for it. Couldn't handle the packet loss of, you know, what would be the demands of a serious competitive FPS. So I don't know, like, just generally for me,
it required user investment before they would be able to fund something that would be able to make it better. So it's like,
exactly.
Now it's just an indie game console.
Yeah.
Not even
Black Ops the Classified is a game that was so bad that the developers had to include a free download code for a PSP game.
Yeah.
Just to make up for it.
And it was, and the thing was like, that was, you know, the me like coming up like thinking that wasn't like me being brilliant in prognosticating about the PS Vita or anything. It was because their f***ing advertising leading up to it was plastered in it. It was just like,
you're
going to get the same hardcore experience.
Yeah, it's a portable PS3 and all that.
Exactly. So a lot of it was like, I feel like, regardless of, you know, maybe like the sort of decisions that they make, it was people felt a real sense of bait and switch between, you know, what they were promised and what they got. And if there's one thing you don't do to gamers is promise big and then not deliver on it. And, you know, it's you will feel the wrath.
I think that
I feel like Sony, on Sony or anything, but like Sony has done that in the past. Not to say that Microsoft and Nintendo hasn't, but like Sony has just like a track record of doing that.
Right.
It's so weird with the Vita because there's so many like really strange choices that still don't make any sense, like why every PSP game and PS1 game isn't playable on the Vita, like why you can't play Metal Gear Solid 1 or Crash Bandicoot.
Well, I mean, sir, it's a lot of that is kind of like sort of with the backwards compatibility thing. It isn't necessarily a representation of the capabilities of the tech, but more like publishing and legally things and what platform stuff can be actually pushed out to and things like that. And getting it, as with a lot of stuff where you're like, why is it so simple? Why can't we do that? The answer is lawyers.
Yeah, and not to mention when they decided to make UMDs the discs for PSP, they kind of screwed up and made everything just because
I
of
like
piracy,
the UMDs. I defend them. They're not perfect, but I like them.
In comparison to like the cards they have now, which are pretty much equal to, you know, the 3DS like DS cartridges, like those work out to be a lot better for
Of course, it's definitely an improvement. I didn't hate them at the time. I could say that at the very
least. It's not only just that. It's like there's games that you can play on the PSP and you can download them, and you can also download PS1 games onto the PSP.
You ever have like
there's PS3. Just a lot of PSP titles that aren't allowed, like they weren't sold digitally, they were only physical games.
Yeah, I know, but there's also PSP games that are sold digitally that you can't play on the Vita either. but you can download and play. Like Valkyria Chronicles 2, you can download and play on a PSP. You can download and just hold the file on your PS3.
The reason you can get around that is because then it assumes you at least own one actual copy of it rather than being digitally available and sold again. So it's like that's at that point, like from a legal standpoint, that point of purchase has already happened. And
right.
So they're like, yeah, you can put it on there. We don't care.
Yeah.
Sort of thing.
There's even some PSP games that are compatible with the Vita, but not with the PlayStation TV, which is weird. Like I can't play Dracula X on my PSP.
But doesn't like the PlayStation TV doesn't just blow up your PSP games? Like you just get a pixelated thing anyway.
Yeah, sorta. I mean, it's not like PSP. I mean, it's not like PSP games had a great high resolution anyway.
You're absolutely right. But like, still, it's just I saw value in the PlayStation TV for like maybe streaming from like your PS4 to another room.
Mm-hmm.
Except for the latency issue, I felt like that is something that really needed to be fixed. But how good are you going to get it anyway?
Right.
Like, you're depending on your internet connection, really.
It's $20. I mean, it's like a pretty good deal.
Yeah. The PlayStation TV is only $20?
You can get one usually for $20 because no one's buying them.
I was going to say, I'm pretty sure
they're anywhere between $20 and $40.
It's not that bad.
Yeah. And
quite cheap.
Exactly.
But I wanted to, one thing that I did like about the PSP is there's, when you put in a UMD into the PSP and it starts to run, there's this like really satisfying hum, like the whirring of the machine. I don't know what it is. So like just,
it's overworking itself, Adam. It
felt like magic was happening. Felt like, you know, that was like exciting.
It was a tiny version of the sound you hear when a console is reading a disc.
Yeah, no, it was.
And it was adorable.
It was so pleasant. It was very nice. Yeah, I liked it. So
then you're like, wow, the UMDs were terrible anyway.
Yeah,
but you know, when I think about it, I did enjoy the sound when you hit it. You were playing a game on your PSP, and it made like a little jingle.
Mm-hmm.
Like
oh,
when
yeah.
you selected the game, I enjoy all the PlayStation jingles. Like, when you start with the PS3, little orchestra, the PSP version. The PS4 doesn't really... I mean, it has one, but it hasn't grown on yet, but I'm sure it will.
I really hope that the PSP becomes, like, sort of a legacy. Like a legacy of our age of gaming. You know what I mean?
It kind of is. It's gotten, like, sort of a cult following. Because it's... First off, you can hack it and run any emulator.
Oh, yeah, pretty much.
Like, any old console. Mm-hmm. And B, it didn't necessarily have a great library, but there's still pretty good stuff on
there. There's solid stuff on there. There's significant
stuff that you've never really played, but like you can enjoy, like Persona 2 or Valkyria Chronicles.
Right, right.
And just stuff like that.
Kind of want to get into one of our topics this week. Not the fan topics yet, sorry. But if you have any of your own fan topics, please send us to Zelda Informer Podcast.
From the fan topics.
@gmail.com. Sorry, Colin. Once again, that's ZeldaInformerPodcast@gmail.com. Send us your fan topics, theme song submissions, any artwork you want to show us, anything like that. Or just stop by and say hi. Feel free.
I want someone to ask us what our favorite gum is again.
Mm-hmm.
Adam, we got an awesome message this last week from a fan.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
I love hearing from everyone that always sends us like such kind words. It's really nice. So thank you. We get them in all the time, and it's always so, so humbling to know that you guys really care. So thank you for that. Anyway, let's get into a topic that I really wanted to get into this week. There's a few. I want to talk about how the new Pro Skater, there wasn't any review copy sent out.
Mm-hmm.
So there's not... They didn't send out review copies initially. Why do you think that is? Like, do you think that's like a bad thing or a good thing? I saw this and I just thought how strange it was because, you know, a lot of companies, they rely on these early reviews to, you know, get people interested in buying the game. I know a lot of times it doesn't work out in their favor, but people seem to rely on these reviews to know if it's worth the purchase. I guess the argument for it would just be there's too much bias in review, but I want to know what you guys think.
Maybe Activision didn't want people to know they were going to sell a broken game.
Is it broken?
Let's ask our expert on this game right now, which is Matthew Dannevik.
God. I mean, it doesn't seem like it's fully broken, but it's not good. I mean, there was that day one patch of 7 gigabytes.
Oh my!
To the game itself apparently was 5 gigabytes long or big. So I mean,
that's small.
They had to. Yeah. Well, I mean, you can tell the graphics look like 2005.
So it wasn't finished.
I've heard from people that if you play the game unpatched, it only plays the tutorial and the create a park. The patch is actually the rest of the game.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's nuts.
Well, and it's like, I don't know. They dicked around a little bit with the formula of it. It just doesn't feel very smooth. For some reason, I mean, if you're familiar with it, like, when you go to like grind, hit Y, it like they stomp down now instead of like, you know, letting you float down, and if you're holding down Y then you're grinding. So it's this really just sort of like jerky, not flowy gameplay that's just sort of like bleh. And then you definitely will hit like mystery corners that'll just make you go flying for no reason, which is not good. Interesting.
It had the same problem that Tony Hawk HD had, which is just being slow.
Yeah, well, I mean, also, I like, granted, I was playing on the Xbox One, so I didn't really know, like, other than visually telling if I was getting major frame drop or if it was just kind of like, you know, taking a dump on its own or how stuff was going. You know, like it was just it felt very disjointed and it wasn't running smoothly, which was a big surprise, considering that it's, you know, a game from today and the graphics are very, very old and simple.
Right. But I still want to ask, you know, review copies. A lot of gamers rely on them. Do you guys think that review copies are a trend that should die, or do you think it should keep going? Do you think it's like worth it? You know, some people they do kind of rely on like movie reviews before they go and see a film, but a lot of people don't care. They'll go and see it anyway, and they'll just kind of let themselves figure out if they like it or not.
Adam, I'm gonna tell you something, okay? The answer is I have no clue, because it seems like that
it's a tricky subject.
Review copies or not, it really just comes down to how the game is. Because I remember last year in April, review copies went out early for Watch Dogs, and that game ended up being really, really mediocre. But at the same time, the guys behind Wolfenstein the New Order were withholding reviews and not letting anyone see or play the game until it came out, and everyone thought the game was going to be bad, but it ended up being supremely good. And this all happened in a span of 1 week. So really, it's just that you can't win with these things, and
it's like it's bittersweet.
Yeah, it's just it could be whatever.
If it's funny, like that people put so much weight. Some people put so much weight on reviews and things like that. I think you can really. It's not hard to get a sense of if a game is bad or not from when a game's coming out, if they start putting some media out for it. Like people aren't surprised that Tony Hawk Pro Skater 5 is like broken and bad. They're just surprised how broken and bad it is. Like if you look at any of the trailers or any other stuff, you know, I don't recommend looking at comments, but if you look at like ups and thumbs up and thumbs down, you kind of get a general sense of, yeah, this game's not going to be good. It isn't really a surprise. And so like, well, you know, previews and things, like, I'm not trying to talk myself out of a job here or anything, but
I think
previews. Yeah.
I think it's important for some people because they're making a big time investment. They're making a $60, sometimes $80 investment.
Yeah.
And it's hard to do that just blindly. So I've mentioned this before, that I think that gaming journalism is good because there's bias in it, like any other form of media. But once you understand the guys that tend to understand you, that's the idea, is you understand who's reviewing the game so that you understand if they are truly representing your opinion. Let's say you really like Greg Miller and his stance on video games, and you rely on him and his team for gaming reviews. You're never going to be disappointed if they like a game, because you know that he has similar interests to you, and for the most part, his opinion is probably going to be your opinion. Or in the same way.
So then, yeah. So then it's less than like, oh, should games be reviewed or not? Like they should. It's just you need to find the reviewer that's right for you.
Yeah, no, that's definitely it. In the same, like, there's not going to be a Roger Ebert, you know, who's like the end all decision on video games like there are movies. but you need to find someone who has your voice, someone who best represents you in video gaming, so that they can sit through and grind through games that would probably drive you mad. And you don't have to waste your money or your time on things that, you know, really won't satisfy you. And, you know, you.
With that being said, mm-hmm. I just want to say, Matt, you're not my guy.
That's fine. No. That's totally fine with it. Honestly, like reviewing is one of the suckiest jobs to have in all of games.
It's difficult.
It's so tough. Because also, like, kind of tying back into, like, what you're saying about, like, finding a guy that's, like, with you, like, that shares an opinion with you and kind of is like that, people often take it as a rebuke of, like, if someone doesn't like a thing that I like, that it's a personal insult or that it's, like, you know, insulting to, like, how it is. And that's why, like, you know, mm-hmm. negative reviews or positive reviews, it's such a kettle of fish that people have so much emotion invested in this thing.
It's important to also listen to the people that you don't like, because I
applaud anyone who listens to this podcast that likes Wind Waker and knows how much I don't like Wind Waker.
Like, I remember a few Ocarina. Years ago when Game Trailers reviewed Uncharted 2 and they gave it like a 9.2 out of 10 and everyone went like insane and they were like, that's too low of a score. And you're like,
what?
Really? 9.2 is bad?
Yeah, it's not perfect, so that that means that it's automatically an F.
I think Uncharted 2 deserved a 9.2. I think it was pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah. 9.2 is an perfect. Excellent score. Yeah.
But
to me, and also like
you could put
9.2
on
numbers advertisement. And like numbers are such an arbitrary thing. Like everybody has a different scale. Yeah. To me, like a 10 is like a platonic ideal of like the perfect video game that. Can't ever actually exist because the universe and the laws of physics won't allow it.
So you don't think Fallout is going to be a 10 out of 10?
A perfect video game does exist. It's called Doom. and Super Mario Brothers.
No, like those games are great for their time, but they don't, you know. Like it's whenever anybody goes back to like GoldenEye, they're like, holy shit, how did I enjoy this so much?
Well, that's because you have the Octopus controller to get back to.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
I can play Doom on anything, and it just feels good.
There was that guy that hacked Doom onto a fax machine.
There's a guy who hacked Doom into Doom, so...
How meta can we go? Very meta.
Yeah.
But there's... I want to talk about a little bit more, kind of taking a step back, what you were talking about, how gamers, you know, take it as a personal insult if you don't like the game they like. Recently, there's been like a lot of flack and a lot of rage online recently about some very interesting articles WTF is wrong with video games, written by a guy who clearly has the judgmental skills of someone who'd write WTF.
Phil, if you're listening to this, please come to my birthday party.
Yeah, come to his birthday party. Okay,
come to my birthday party. We'll play Space Invaders for the PS1, and we can judge high scores, and we can eat Oreo Friendly's cake.
And
great.
The reason that I insult him in that way is not because I have a personal dislike taste for what he said, but rather I just disliked his arguments or the fact that he didn't use proper arguments for what he was trying to support.
I'm just going to ignore it. The dude,
no, but I'm saying it's like...
The dude has no idea what he's talking about.
Right, but he
only wrote it to piss off people.
Right.
He knew he was going to get the reaction that he did.
There's also
the same spiel that every other idiot on the internet gives.
Yeah, but there's also a former ESPN host that also criticized games recently, and that also caused a bit of outrage.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Yeah, but I'm saying...
is this the same guy who said something after Heroes of the Dorm?
Yeah.
Jeez.
But it's funny because like general media still kind of hates games and gamers, despite it's becoming more popular. You know, you have things like every couple of years a big thing is happening. You know, you had Gamergate starting a few years ago. You still have people looking badly on gamers. You know, esports is only now catching on as being a very big thing. And maybe a lot of people say
that such a counterculture that the man doesn't want to praise us yet.
Maybe, but I feel like if you really think about it, being a gamer itself hasn't really changed much since 30 years ago. I mean, the way that you are a gamer has changed, but not necessarily the sort of aspect of being a gamer.
I think the social aspect of it has changed a lot. It's a lot less awkward.
Right. No, but there's still a social bias for being a gamer. I still feel like that's very present. I still feel like it's still the same sort of culture. It hasn't really changed much. It's just become more widespread because we're in a digital age, but at the same time, it's received a lot more backlash because of that.
I mean, if you look back to the very early beginnings of gaming, you know, like the late 70s, early 80s, video gaming was like almost as mainstream, if not more so, than it was nowadays, which I know is really weird for people to grasp, but like the arcade was an actual like place that people from all ages would go to.
Oh yeah, no.
It's... The Atari 2600 is one of the just best-selling video game systems of all time. There's a reason why you can go to a store and buy Atari games for $1 because there's just so many of them.
Yeah, I mean, even in the 90s, like after the crash and everything, it was still huge. Video games are still huge to an extent. I mean, the reason the Power Glove sold $88 million worth of products says a lot. It's
Fred Savage.
Fred, I'm sorry.
That's a wizard. That's where I got to. Yeah,
so bad.
No. That was an amazingly good product placement. It was. It just sold those things like crazy. And then,
believe it or not, that was probably around the time that the movie studio had to pay Nintendo in order to get their product in there.
Right. No. It's
so weird.
It's nuts. I mean, you had crazy politics going on. You had Nintendo fighting over Capcom, pretty much, with Sega. Sega wanting the Wily Wars to be a Sega-only game. And you just had these insane competitions going on in gaming. It was a busy industry like it is now. There was a strong following for it like it is now.
Opponents back to even say things like the formation of the ESRB and like PEGI and like those associations, because those had to go through like the legal system and like those had to go to like politicians and stuff like that. Like things were up in like the news and like I don't want to just say courthouse.
The content of games was under review back then as it is now, and it survived then. It's going to survive now. I still think that like, maybe in 30 years from now, I don't think that the culture of gaming itself will change. I think that maybe it'll expand, but I think that it's proven that it will stay at a constant rate.
Maybe it'll be a little more like accepted.
Maybe, possibly.
Unlike the general media.
Possibly.
I mean, for me, I feel like you have to really look back at every kind of era of gaming. And on top of that, the problem with that is that you're only going to have one national view on it, because retro gaming in the US is very different from Japan or Europe or Brazil.
Oh yeah.
Like, fun fact, the video game crash is only exclusive to America. It didn't happen in Japan or Europe.
The Power Glove is only big in America. It wasn't big in Japan.
The NES didn't even sell at all in Europe.
Yeah,
no one bought an NES. Yeah. Sega was king in Europe. And in Japan, Sega didn't have a good system till the Saturn.
A lot of physical games only made it to Europe. Sega Channel was where primarily a lot of games were distributed in North America, which was terrible.
Hell, Japan doesn't even have PC gaming. It's all arcades there.
Sega didn't even sell in Japan. Like, it just didn't sell. It just died in Japan, which is nuts.
You kind of have to look at all the eras of, like, you know, early, like, late 70s, early 80s, the kind of arcade 2600 era. Then you have to look at the NES to early 90s, like, just Nintendo being king when it was pretty much just being sold as a toy, because that was Nintendo's whole, like, angle on it.
It was how they saved video games as
and how
I don't know, man. Sega do what Nintendo don't.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Yeah. Last processing.
There you go. Then you have to look
it did
at
something.
Just the turn of going near the 21st century with all the new technology like CDs and DVDs and all that, and you can't just pin it on one thing. There's so many different eras, and the mindset has changed so much through each one.
But there's still a consistency. There's like a consistent arc, right? Like it rises and falls, but if you look at the numbers, there's a line you can draw.
Well, yeah.
You know, and I think it's stayed pretty leveled despite all the changes.
Maybe there just needs to, like, I don't know. I just have the feeling, because a lot of people now are growing up with games, more mobile games than, like, anything I've seen.
Right, right.
So I feel like just that alone is just, like, a gateway. It's almost like a gateway drug. I could rephrase that if you want me to, Adam.
No, that's fine.
Give me
some of that Sega CD.
I don't care.
No, I have a little brother who's, like, 10 years old, 9 years old. All he ever does is play on his tablet, and then from there he moves on to systems and consoles with
and
all
gets
of his
curious
friends.
For like other things, you know. He's like, "What other games are out there?"
Yeah, the generations, like, they're gonna grow up from kids of every age, size, and shape, and things like that. They're all
games
gonna...
like Flappy Bird and Angry Birds and all that stuff. They're gonna exist in the mobile market, and I think that they will have a significant impact on some children's lives, like getting them into games. But honestly, and this is probably gonna date me very much and make me sound very old. But I don't think that mobile games will last in terms of, like, there's not going to be a retro market for these kind of mobile games in the same way that there is people.
Well, I mean, if they're always around, I don't think they would become retro.
Maybe. I mean, it's just, I don't see.
They won't be called mobile games. They're just small games. Like, it's called the thing is especially with the, like, I would venture to guess that this is probably going to be the last generation of like a Microsoft box at your house or a Sony branded box at your house.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas like all gaming is going to be essentially streamed eventually. And so like that'll mean that processing power isn't going to be limited to what you can hold in your hand or what can be microprocessed in around there. And so like having Call of Duty or whatever, you know, like having like full big stuff in around you, like mobile game, like the designation between a game that you take with you on the go and a game that you have with you at your house is going to be a line that's like born out of like the limitations of antique hardware.
Well, there was always a limitation on how much we could process and transfer data, like how fast we could transfer data. There was always von Neumann's bottleneck, where, you know, it doesn't matter how powerful your machine is, data can only move at such speed in the way that we transfer data. But recently, they found a way to actually transfer, save, and just exchange data using light. So we found the superhighway of data transfer. And I think that you're right in that aspect, that, you know, because of something like that, streaming is going to become possible. Because for those of you who don't understand what that really means, is that basically the idea of a limited data stream is a thing of the past.
This all depends on like people's ISPs and things like
No, but the thing about it's traveling at the speed of light. You're transferring data at literally the speed of light. It's the fastest we can ever possibly send anything, or that anything can be sent.
It's physically moving from one point to another, traveling to those points in between.
Mm-hmm.
Once you warp data,
then you're doing something.
Send it into an alternate dimension.
But there's the idea that
literal quantum computing.
It's the idea that we've created a way that's going to make it possible for essentially unlimited bandwidth, or the human concept of unlimited, where we're possibly never going to use anything that could come close to filling up that amount. And not in the same way that, you know, we thought, you know, oh, we're only going to need two computers at one point. I forget who said that exactly.
And soon enough, Stephen Hawking's going to quit his job and join the gaming industry and help further this.
Well, this is not even just a gaming thing. This is an across the board thing.
Oh, this is across the board. You're absolutely right.
This is like your internet service will be unlimited. There will be no data cap or data limit because there's no reason to.
I'm not sure about
that. Well, market forces will still. It's like,
yeah, AT&T and Verizon, they're going to try to peddle you for every piece of money you have.
I suppose, but there's no reason to. Actually, there's no reason for them to do it now, so.
If the governments get involved and say, hey, this needs to happen, then sure, it'll happen.
I mean, we're kind of in a time where we're still trying to figure that out or figure a way to keep...
Oh, man. L.A. maybe is... I'm pushing for L.A. to get that municipal internet. Oh, so bad. It'd be so great. Oh,
yeah.
I'm
so happy. It's better than internet here in Florida. I can tell you that much.
Oh, I assume so. We got the Silicon Beach.
Yeah. Let's get into some of our hand topics.
Yeah!
Donovan asks, I'm DMing a D&D campaign, and I would like to move it into Hyrule. What would be the best Zelda game map to run the campaign on? Thank you, Donovan, for your question. I thought that was pretty interesting.
Zelda CDI.
Yeah, oh man, you stole my answer! No!
To be fair, Zelda CDI actually has one of the most diverse maps of any Zelda game.
Go on.
There's so many, like, weird areas in that game with, like, different weather and environments. And, like, there's a lava section, there's a snow section. It's like a Mario game.
I mean, there's a variety of sections in a lot of Zelda games. I don't think it's just Zelda CDI. I mean, I know, but I'm just...
I actually had an idea of, like, a good one, and I think Adam would be pleased about this, although I would object after saying it. It's the map of Link to the Past.
I was gonna say that actually.
Yeah, because like going between like worlds in a way. Like,
yeah, there's a light world and a dark world, which adds another level of like possibility and like complexity. You can make
two different rounds.
You can make
in
references
one D&D game.
Back to things that already happened in the campaign by upping the difficulty and keeping a similar map structure. Being like, you know, this is kind of what you're used to, but not quite. I think that players would appreciate that. There would be similarly recurring characters, but you'd see another side of them almost. And I think it has enough variety to satisfy players.
As my joke answer, I want to put Wind Waker because water.
Just boat adventures.
As my not joke answer, I'm going to put Link to the Past.
There's a good video by Spoonie. It's called "Don't Get on the Boat," and it's about how like DMs when they have like all these water monsters in their NPC manuals, they get like, you know, I really want to put this Kraken creature, but I don't have anywhere to put them. And so they make you get on a boat just so they can do that water fight. And whoever's wearing heavy armor drowns immediately because they're not made to swim. And nobody ever invests in swimming because it's not a skill that anyone ever uses in D&D. So yeah, not Wind Waker, because all you're going to do is make a team of swimmers. As the player character is like, well, 90% of the map is water, so we might as well.
Someone call Octopip and Sparky the Android.
Yeah, Brett, where's your D&D campaign, nerd?
For 50% off?
Yeah, no, I know.
That's what we need.
Yeah, go watch that, by the way. It's a good series. Anyway, good friends. They were on an episode before. Both of them were on episodes in the past a while ago. But yeah, I think the length of the past map is good. If you want something a little bit shorter and a little bit more condensed, you could follow Four Sword Adventures. Because those have very, very distinct areas that are all very condensed and very, you know, held together.
Oh, you could do Minish Cap, and you could shrink to the size of an ant.
Yeah, you could. You could combine.
Or Minish.
You could actually combine the Link to the Past and Minish Cap ideas.
They happen in the same, like, timeline, pretty sure. So, right. Like, the lands exist.
Right. I mean, just, like, the idea of, you know, shrinking down, also having a dark world and stuff. You could make multiple layers of the same area, really. I think that's...
Yeah.
That's a good way to, you know, keep the familiarity while also keeping it interesting for your player.
Yeah.
If it's a horror campaign, you do Majora's Mask.
There you go.
Yeah. Yeah. Or you do Wind Waker, because there's nothing more horrific than being stuck on a boat for 3 months. Because D&D campaigns take a while.
Gosh, don't go on the boat.
Yeah, don't go on the boat. Your fighter's just going to drown. And you're going to be like, oh, well, now we don't have any killing power.
Or you're going to get sucked into a cyclone and end up where you don't want to be.
Yeah. Back on the boat.
No! Why?
But yeah, that's our suggestion. Michael asks, hey, Zelda Informer Podcast. My question this week is, what would sell you on the Pokemon Go game? I think it'd be one of the best mobile games ever. Thank you, Michael, for your...
3DS port.
Michael, if... you know what would sell me on it? If it were real... Like the advertisements, but it's
yeah,
not.
The advertisements are very, very misleading. I mean, Pokemon tends to have very flamboyant advertisements, but the fact is they didn't show enough of the game to really...
They didn't have enough Dylan Cole Sprouse. That's what didn't do it for me. If you didn't have Dylan and Cole Sprouse walking on the beach, say, I'm playing Pokemon Red Dark Gold version, and I'm playing Pokemon Silver version with their Pokewalkers. Yeah. That's, if they would have had that, I would have been
well,
sold.
They showed, like, one screenshot of the game, and it looked like a really watered-down version of a like, older Pokemon games, and I'm just like, that doesn't look good.
Yeah, if it didn't integrate with microtransactions, it would also sell me on.
Oh, yeah, the fact that we already know that there's going to be microtransactions is very, very, very uncomfortable.
If it wasn't a preview to the new Android system, Project NX, then I would also be happy about it.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah. That's just my opinion, Michael. That's what would sell. I'm probably going to download it anyway, but, like, regardless.
I mean, I'm going to wait till there's, like, actually information before
it's
going to
be
up or just completely shit on it, but...
Isn't it going to be a free download on your phone with microtransactions? Pretty sure, right?
Yeah, but so was Fallout Shelter, so...
but Fallout Shelter...
Fallout Shelter is a rare example of doing a mobile game right.
But see, that's, you know, that's
but even
exactly
then,
the
it's
thing,
still
though,
not...
That
it's not very satisfying.
You can apply that to anything.
Fallout Shelter's tiny tower with the Fallout skin on it. There.
Yeah,
well, yeah, there you go.
No, but Pete Hines, he sold it so well to us. Yeah, it's kind of good.
It's
kind of great.
It's kind of good, but it doesn't really satisfy me at all.
Does it not?
No, no, it really doesn't. Adam, it's very empty. I would love it if at some point that was somehow relevant to Fallout 4. Like, there's a vault on the map dedicated to your version of Fallout Shelter that you could, like, get a code and, like, type it in and throw all your stuff in there. Like, at least the layout. I think that'd
you know,
be kind of neat.
They've been throwing curveballs at us for this last few months, so you never know.
Maybe.
I doubt it, but you never know.
Maybe. We'll see. But Pokemon Go, what would sell it for me? Make it a game I don't have to play with other people. I don't want to play Pokemon with other people. I mean, I understand there's like a trading aspect to it, but there was Crystal version for a reason. I liked Crystal version a lot.
There you go.
Yeah.
Sorry for crushing your dreams, Michael. I just wanted to let you know what was up about that.
Yeah, we're just making assumptions. Anyway, next question.
I mean, that's all we can do is because they haven't really released enough information yet. They still made a commercial, which seems very strange.
If you have to travel to certain places in the world
to get
to
Pokemon,
get rare Pokemon.
Like, I love seeing posts on like Tumblr. They're like, oh, we need to go to the bottom of the ocean, or oh, it's a typhoon, I need to go get Lugia. It's like, you're just gonna die. Like, people are gonna die from this, and then they're gonna have to pull it off the market.
So really, what Nintendo's doing, they're working on population control.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's really like, whoever suggested this idea, if it really is what I think it is, with, like, you know, special events and all that stuff, they're playing a dangerous game, because I feel like people are going to hurt themselves.
They shut down Times Square at, like, 4 a.m. just to film that.
Yeah.
They're down.
That's a lot
of
money.
That was great.
That is a very expensive thing to do.
What? Watch, there's going to be a Pokemon murder. A guy's going to figure out where the rarest Pokemon is, and he's just going to wait with a gun. And people are going to be distracted on their phones, and when they get there, he's just going to shoot them in the head.
Oh, yeah.
The only thing that's going to go is your body to death. He's not very good he's not very good at one-liners, but he's pretty good.
He has a gun.
I mean, he's playing Pokemon on his phone.
While also murdering people.
Yeah.
It could also just work on a grid system where the phone just requires you to walk one direction however many steps in another direction.
That would make sense.
And it'll randomly generate something.
That would make sense.
Oh, that's no fun. That's no fun.
I mean, that's how Pokemon actually
works. I
want to
have
to
travel to
okay.
New Zealand to go get, like, Entei. Yeah. You know? I want it to be exciting. I want them to make me want to travel. I want to go to Matt's house to find Psyduck. That's like my goal. And I'll go to Adam's house to find, like... Adam, what's your least favorite Pokemon?
Beedrill.
Alright, I'm gonna go find Pikachu at Adam's house.
Sweet. yeah. Let's get into our last fan topic for this week, because I know that we're on a limited schedule this time. Just time delays. Sorry about that.
No worries.
Yeah, just out of nowhere. Sean from New York asks... We were supposed to cover this last
week. Hey, I know that place.
It's a place where you live. How would you guys feel if they implemented a buddy system similar to the one in Metal Gear in Zelda U? For example, right before you leave a certain town in the game or an important area, you can pick a character come along with Link, like Impa or Zelda. Sean from New York. Thank you so much,
Sean. It was called Hyrule Warriors.
Hyrule Warriors is pretty cool.
It's funny that they say this because you know how this Metal Gear game is like, oh, it's first real open world Metal Gear game. And they're trying to like say that this Zelda U is going to be like the first real open world Zelda game. Mm-hmm. So it's I find that kind of funny.
Well, imagine if, however, imagine if you had like a series of companions, like you had a fairy companion, you had a talking object companion, and they all had different things or different kinds of advice. Like one's good at finding
you
secrets.
You had a shadow companion.
One is good at at combat. You know, you could have like your shadow be a companion, like sort of a Peter Pan-esque thing. And they all have different kinds of advice.
Like
that'd actually be cool. Like the hat, like let's say you have like another Ezlo-esque character and he knows a lot about dungeon layouts. About, he knows where to find...
And talking back and sassing and making funny jokes.
The shadow knows where to find secrets in the map. He's like, you know, if you look behind this rock, you might find something interesting. And then you have your Navi who just tells you about how you're not doing what she wants you to do.
I mean...
Listen!
Honestly, I don't think I would want that just because that seems very not Zelda. However, if they want to try new things with this game and they think they got something good, go ahead. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not going to, you know, dismiss them for that.
Right.
But don't do it in a way where it's do it in a way where I need to choose different people, like for certain, like, you know, dungeons and stuff, because that would make the game more interesting. It would less boring, in fact, like, because then I wouldn't be stuck with one partner the entire time.
I actually hope that they stick to the theme of it being a return to the older Zelda games, specifically the first one, and make it just, like, Link on his own.
Link on his own is the goal. It's the dream. But if they were to do a partner system, that's how I'd want it.
I like the idea of companions. I think that it'd be an interesting twist. But it doesn't necessarily have to take away from the idea of going back to their roots.
As long as it's not your sword, your sword's alive, I'm happy.
Yeah. And it's talking to you?
It
has a creepy robot face.
Let's do it.
Like, it's like humanoid in a way.
Stop it.
That's what? Like what I don't like.
Why are you hitting the side of my head up against these
Because
people?
I want you to stop talking. Stop talking.
Okay.
I liked Fi. I didn't. But Adam, you don't like Skyward Sword. I could still appreciate some things about it.
You know, I haven't played enough of Skyward Sword to say I could really hate the person, but I've seen enough where I'm like, that doesn't...
It doesn't change much. Just imagine that over and over again. It doesn't change at all.
They need a breath of fresh air is what they need. Mm-hmm. So,
But the one other thing I did want to talk about, switching gears, is the Pokemon Butts thing. Because never before have I seen a company do something that is so amazing and yet so ridiculous. And that's saying a lot considering it's video games. Because it's literally a product line from the Pokemon company based on Pokemon butts. It's not a joke.
Look at
the article below. There's an entire gallery of Pokemon butts. You got Pikachu butt. You got
Listen, Adam, I don't wanna like stop your fascination of Pokemon butts, but I have some pretty important news. There's a new translated episode of Game Center CX right now.
By the way, okay.
Just released.
If you know the show, if you know me, you know that I like Game Center CX a lot, and you should be watching it with us and emailing us about it or tweeting at us about it, because I love the Chief, and you should too. It's
just put a link to the website.
You know what? Yeah,
below.
Check down below
By
if
the
you
way,
haven't seen it before.
two new episodes in 1 week.
Can
I'm
you
really
explain
excited.
How to
really
look at the website for
that.
A little bit, like briefly, which ones they should be looking at? Because I know there's a little bit confusing for which ones are available in English subtitles.
Just go on the website. There's going to be a list of all the episodes of the show, and pretty much each one of those episodes will lead you to a download link where you can download the episode and watch it. Some you can't watch or grayed out because they haven't been translated yet, or they have been translated and the translation's been lost, so they have to do it again. And some are clickable, but will link you to an Amazon page because they were released on DVD and they want you to buy the DVD for those episodes. Yeah.
Is an episode that you would recommend, Colin?
The episode I recommend watching is Tokimeki Memorial. It's a dating sim for the PlayStation 1.
One of my favorites.
And it is hilarious watching him play. But I also recommend episodes like Super Mario Land or Ghosts and Goblins.
Yeah, speaking of things that you should be watching, Chris, what do you recommend this week?
Watch Inside Gaming Daily featuring...
You should be watching Inside Gaming.
featuring our special guest, Matthew Dannevik.
Yeah, watch Matt.
Don't watch that.
Watch it.
Do it.
Watch it. Okay. Tweet at him. Maybe I'm going to tweet at you, Matt. I'm going to watch it this week.
Please tweet at me.
I'm going to tweet at you about how you're such a cutie.
It's Monday through Friday most of the time, unless they're out, or it's just like Phil doing it by himself.
No.
And it's great, and they talk about all your gaming needs.
Yeah. All of your needs.
All the needs you don't get from here.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's true. But we're complimentary needs.
Yeah, exactly.
There.
Also, this float cell bug is the only appealing one because it seems to be the only one that have butt cheeks.
Yeah, how's it going to be a butt without an anus?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
It is important. Oh, they have boxers too.
Yeah, Pikachu boxers.
This is great.
What if those are just for kids and you buy them, Adam, and they just rip as soon as you put them on?
That'd be horrible.
That would be really funny.
I'd be very disappointed.
Feel like 0 stars out of 10. This is not a great purchase if you're looking to buy this and you're in a
this is ass and not in the good way. Not in the way that I was promised. anyway.
Oh, there was that Smash Brothers update.
Yeah, there was.
With,
there was a few new maps. Check them out.
Some new costumes for the Miis, if you're into that, which you shouldn't be. I don't know. I guess stages and characters are the only real important news. But nothing too special. It was just
they
like Return of
Smolcius. They did release a Rathalos Mii costume.
I saw that. I saw a few of them, actually. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's cute. So check it out down below. Be all there. Yeah.
Matt, I have a question for you.
Certainly.
So you are a part-time streamer occasionally.
Every once in a while.
You stream like the MOBAs and such with friends.
Sometimes, yeah.
Okay, so I got a question for you about this new thing called YouTube gaming.
Uh-huh.
What do you think about all that? Because I'm pretty sure your last stream was via YouTube and not Twitch for like the first time.
I just sort of did whatever's like convenient, and like honestly my OBS was still set to YouTube gaming, so that's what it's it wasn't really as much of a conscious choice though, since my like Twitch channel isn't partnered, it gets throttled, whereas YouTube gaming technically is supposed to deliver a higher fidelity viewing experience for the audience. And also, I mean, I just have way more subscribers on YouTube than I do Twitch. But really, I mean, generally, is in terms of, like, for the market and how, you know, how it's affecting it and whatnot. I think it's a good thing. There's, you know, I don't really, like, there was a little while when YouTube looked like, whatchamacallit.
Not very good.
Yeah. Yeah, when we people were really upset about that and whatnot, and I mean, like, the big sort of big MCNs were excited, but like, you know, from a standpoint of a consumer, having these two things split up is really just going to be a bonus for you, because they're going to have to keep on one-upping each other,
yeah,
keep offering better services.
Well,
finally, Twitch moved over to HTML5.
Yeah.
And now Twitch is also, I believe it was this week, at TwitchCon, they announced that you can now upload videos to Twitch.
Yeah, something. I know. Well, yeah, they're like switching, switching positions.
Yeah.
They're trying to match positions, really. They're trying to match the features of the other site. But I think that Twitch is still going to be considered the streaming king. But I think that you're just going to have to try to... Hopefully, they're going to push and make it more worthwhile for people to move over. I know that Game Grumps does it through their YouTube channel. I think it's more that established channels that have an established YouTube following, this is convenient for them because it lets their viewers...
Like, this would benefit Machinima more when they stream, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, there's a weird, like, conversion rate because, like, channel, depending on... You still haven't really found out a good way within YouTube to drive people to your live events.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because, yeah, there are a lot of people, you know, with millions of things. Yeah. Where it's like people have millions of subscribers and it's still, you know, you're
it's
still
really for
doing
big channels
sub
so far,
1,000.
Yeah.
And even then, big channels, like, they're not getting the craziest, the subscriber rate really isn't a good predictor.
Yeah. I know that Game Grumps does like live streams now, and those numbers are closer to 10,000, and they're in over 2 million at this point, which seems like appallingly low ball. in comparison.
Right.
And that's just because a lot.
Well, at least for a marketing, like for ad dollars and marketing mm-hmm. sense, a live stream viewer is worth way more than a VOD.
Well, a live stream viewer tends to invest engaged. A little bit more time and energy into viewing because they know that there's a chance of interacting with the person that they're watching. There's more of a connection with the thing that they're watching, and
not to mention it's a live event, and live events tend to be like one time only.
Yeah, yeah.
Unless
well,
you save
does YouTube
the
have
footage.
Save functions for their videos for live stream?
Yeah, it automatically yeah. archives everything
okay.
you have.
Because I know
like,
some channels don't
there, like,
put that up.
Yeah. No, it's because you know
it's
well,
exclusivity.
Like, I mean,
they
yeah,
want to like make you come to the thing, which is smart, but at the same time, it'd be good to post clips.
Like highlights.
Not exactly highlights, but like some highlights. Not be like this and more was like you know
things to bring you to the next stream, so to speak.
Say like here's a teaser of what amazing stuff was going on during the stream. You know, like there was a stream. I'm just bringing up Game Grumps. That's the one I know the most. Because I did a few mm-hmm. times just to understand what the whole YouTube streaming thing was like. They had Oni and from Sleepy Cabin and Spaz Kid. And they made Brian made him eat, try and eat an apple in two bites, and it was hilarious. There was a Twitter trend where people were trying to do the same thing. Oni was in pain the entire time, and Brian was just forcing him to do it. And that's not something that you would see unless you were at the stream. And now there's like all these the Game Grumps fans are like tweeting about it, and the ones that are also Game Grumps fans, probably friends on Twitter and things like that, they're seeing them talk about the stream like, oh, what's going on? It's like, oh, the Game Grumps stream, you know, they did this thing, and it's like, oh my god, I wish I was there. And so it's trying to like drive that traffic. So there's a cleverness to it, but I still think that, you know, it would be good to have something else on the channel just showing people what they're missing out on.
Yeah,
at
definitely.
All times.
I mean, it's. They also, like, it's a whole parallel site to regular YouTube, like gaming.youtube.
Yeah, you just put it gaming
on there.
I don't like the layout, to be honest.
It's a little
It's
weird.
A lot. It's just a darker layout, really. It's darker and it's more Twitch-like. It's if you like more gray, then you do light gray. Then
I mean, I like Twitch because it's Twitch, and I like YouTube because it's YouTube. Mm-hmm. Like, they should be themselves and not try to be the other person, but I understand that's how you, like, that's how you make competition happen, right? But you know, to each their own.
Yeah.
Also, I have a follow up for you, Matt. When's your next Hot Pepper Gaming?
Oh God, I don't even know. I hung out with Vernon a couple days ago.
Oh, tell him I said hi.
I mean, I've already. Oh yeah, definitely.
Good
friend of the show.
I've done two.
Wow.
So you know, I get like I'll every once in a while get. Like a thing where Vernon's or Jared are like, hey, we're doing a thing, and you know, as much as I do want to like totally like respond, one, I don't want to like hog the opportunities.
Right.
You know how many people have done like three or four already?
Sure. So, but then the other reason is like, you know, each time you go on, you can't just like. Do what you did before.
You have to try and spice things up.
Yeah,
in a way.
You have to spice things up. Exactly.
I got a challenge for you.
And then I don't really know. I mean, I do like spicy food, but
here's,
don't know if
here's
I want
my
to
challenge
do
to you.
That.
I'm issuing this now.
Okay.
And if you're listening to the podcast and Matt does it again, be sure to watch. You have to sing your next review, or at least add you have to sing while you're doing.
I kind of sung it though at my first one.
With the Destiny beta, was that
the
first
Destiny
one?
Beta, yeah, Destiny beta. I kind of because it used like I definitely wrote a whole bunch on the page that you have sort of mm-hmm. like out there in front of you, and I start kind of belaboring the point in them.
Okay.
Like, oh wait, no, I gotta get the sooner I get through this, the better. It's
how about
happen.
This?
And so I kind of
you just need more spice.
Speak in haikus.
Yeah. Okay. Oh jeez, that'll be real tough. It'll be real tough keeping the like counting each time. Oh,
I mean,
man.
If you're writing the
yeah.
review in advance, you could
yeah,
prepare
that's true.
For it. That'd be great.
Might be getting out of it a little easier.
I don't know.
But yeah, Hot Pepper Gaming's great. Those guys are fantastic.
Yeah,
you can go follow them on Twitter and YouTube.
Follow
yes.
them; they're great. Brennan's one of my favorite people online. I don't really get to talk
to
him as much as I wish
Brennan's
I could.
Brennan's awesome. He's supremely talented.
And he's a sweetheart.
Going places. Yeah.
Yeah, I guess that's all the time we have for this week. I know it's a little shorter than what we're used to.
I'm sorry. I'm a time thief guy. I apologize.
It happens. We're busy people with busy lives. I was almost late to this recording, so I mean, it was by like a minute or two, but I'm sorry about that. Yeah, so I understand.
Yeah.
But yeah, thank you again for those of you who joined us this week and have been joining us for a long time, or if this is your first episode, welcome. If you have any of your own topics, theme song submissions, or anything like that, feel free to send this to us at ZeldaInformerPodcast@gmail.com. Once again, that's ZeldaInformerPodcast@gmail.com. I've been Adam. That's been Chris. That's been Colin. That's been Matt.
Yeah.
You can follow all of us on Twitter. And check out links down below for...
Subscribe to the Nintendo Kid.
Yeah. Yeah. All that will be down below. Click, share, like the podcast.
Wish me happy birthday a day after this is posted.
Oh, is it? Yeah, it will be. Yeah.
Yeah,
happy birthday, Chris.
Thanks.
Happy birthday, Chris.
Yay.
Thanks, Matt.
Happy day of your birth.
Oh, thank you.
I got you,
Colin.
For your birthday, Chris.
Did you?
Yeah.
Is it Matt?
It's Warp Star.
Oh, take care. I got you a thing for your birthday. A one-way ticket to hell.
Oh, no.
Oh, geez.
Oh, no.
That sounds almost as
podcast
bad as
over.
Pro Skater 5.
Podcast over. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.